Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on the parathyroid hormone. A few things that are good to know before learning about this hormone is how calcium and phosphate are distributed in the body, how the kidney handles them, and how bone cells work. I will leave links to videos I've got on this stuff in the description box below in case you'd like to use any of them. But now we're going to look at the parathyroid hormone. The parathyroid hormone is synthesized and secreted by the parathyroid glands. There are usually four glands situated on the posterior surface of the thyroid gland. These glands have cells called chief cells which synthesize PTH. That's the abbreviation usually used for this hormone. It first gets synthesized as a longer peptide called pre-pro-PTH, which then gets shortened in the rough endoplasmic reticulum to form pro-PTH. And then the Golgi apparatus removes a few more amino acids, secreting an 84 amino acid intact PTH, which is biologically active. This PTH gets broken down into fragments, mainly in the Kupffer cells of the liver. But what stimulates these cells to produce PTH? Changes in the plasma calcium levels, because PTH is the main calcium-regulating hormone in the body. Now, I could summarize the actions of PTH in just three sentences. It increases plasma calcium, decreases plasma phosphate, and it's needed for 1-alpha-hydroxylation of vitamin D. That's actually all you need to know, but in the rest of this video, we're going to build on that. To understand how PTH regulates calcium, first we need to know what happens to calcium in the body. I'm going to quickly go over that now. We get calcium through diet. It reaches the small intestine where it gets absorbed and reaches the extracellular fluid. Calcium also gets secreted in GI fluids back into the intestine. Most calcium is excreted by the GI system. The calcium in the extracellular fluid can exchange with cells. Calcium gets deposited in bones, and those bones form a reservoir. So bone resorption, which is the digestion of bone matrix, would put calcium back into the extracellular fluid. The kidney filters plasma, and with it, calcium, but most of the filtered calcium gets reabsorbed, and a very small amount gets excreted by the kidneys. That's three organs that PTH can work with to regulate plasma calcium when its levels change. When there's low calcium, PTH increases. What does that increased PTH do? Brings calcium back up towards normal. Instead, high plasma calcium inhibits the release of PTH, lowering it. That lowers plasma calcium, bringing it back towards normal. Homeostasis. It senses this change in plasma calcium by a receptor, appropriately called the calcium-sensing receptor. That receptor is obviously located on the cells of the parathyroid gland. This receptor is coupled to a G protein, which activates phospholipase C. That converts phosphatidyl inositol 4,5-bisphosphate into diacylglycerol and inositol triphosphate, DAG and IP3. DAG activates protein kinase C. IP3 mobilizes calcium out of the endoplasmic reticulum. Now, these two usually would stimulate the release of a hormone. But with PTH, it's the opposite. They inhibit the release of the parathyroid hormone. When the plasma calcium is high, calcium binds to that receptor, and PTH secretion reduces. If you don't want to remember all of this, this part is what you really need. Low calcium stimulates the release of PTH. High calcium inhibits the release of PTH. Now, if PTH has to fix low calcium, how can it do that? By acting on these three organs. On the kidney, it can increase the reabsorption of calcium. That puts more calcium back into the ECF. On bone, it can increase bone resorption, again bringing the plasma calcium back up. In the kidney, calcium gets reabsorbed in three parts: the proximal tubule, the thick ascending limb of the loop of Henle, and the distal convoluted tubule. The proximal tubule is not under hormonal control, so PTH doesn't work there. It works on the other two and increases calcium reabsorption, and thus there will be less calcium excreted by the kidney. It does this by acting on its receptor. Usually that's the PTH1 receptor, which is coupled to a G protein. This is a different G protein, GS, which activates adenylyl cyclase, converting ATP to cyclic AMP, and that cyclic AMP activates protein kinase A, phosphorylating proteins and increasing calcium reabsorption. Basically, via cyclic AMP, that's what you need to remember. Bone too has receptors for the parathyroid hormone. In bone, PTH can act rapidly or slowly. Bone has cells, osteoblasts, osteocytes, and osteoclasts. Osteoblasts are bone-forming cells. Osteoclasts destroy bone matrix. And osteocytes are trapped osteoblasts in the bone matrix with cytoplasmic extension sitting in canaliculi. The osteocytes are connected to each other and the osteoblasts by gap junctions. Gap junctions allow ions to move between the cells. The rapid action of PTH involves osteocytes and osteoblasts because they have receptors for this hormone. PTH can get these cells to increase their calcium uptake. It can activate calcium pumps on these cells. Where do they take up the calcium from? Bone fluid. And they'll transfer it to the ECF. Bone fluid calcium goes down and the extracellular fluid calcium goes up. This process is called osteocytic osteolysis. Calcium and phosphate salts are being released by bone, lysis of bone by the osteocytes. But there's no digestion of the bone matrix by osteocytes. When these calcium pumps get inactivated, the bone fluid calcium goes back up again, and calcium can get deposited in the bone matrix along with phosphate. But the net effect of persistent increase in PTH is to resorb bone, destroy it to put calcium back into the extracellular fluid. This is the slow phase of action, and that is by using those osteoclasts, because now we're going to digest the bone matrix. But osteoclasts don't have receptors for this hormone. Osteoblasts, on the other hand, do. But osteoblasts are bone-forming cells. We need to destroy bone. So how would this work? Osteoblasts regulate osteoclasts. And PTH binds to its receptor on the osteoblast. There's the release of cytokines, like macrophage colony stimulating factor, the RANK ligand. What do these cytokines do? They act on osteoclast precursor cells and convert them to active osteoclasts. These osteoclasts then find a nice cozy spot on bone and start digesting it. They release hydrogen ions and enzymes like acid phosphatases and acid proteases. In this now acidic environment, bone matrix gets broken down, releasing calcium and phosphate into the bloodstream. So when low calcium stimulates the release of PTH, it can cause bone resorption and increase the plasma calcium levels back up to normal again. That's how PTH directly acts on the kidneys and bones. But in the intestines, if the plasma calcium is low, how can PTH fix that? By increasing calcium absorption. PTH does this, yes, but not directly. It does this through vitamin D. If you remember the third sentence in my list, it activates vitamin D. The last step of vitamin D synthesis involves hydroxylating 25-hydroxycholecalciferol, which is not active, to 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol, which is active. That is done in the kidneys with an enzyme called 1-alpha-hydroxylase, where inactive vitamin D becomes active vitamin D. This enzyme is stimulated by PTH. So PTH activates vitamin D, and then vitamin D is the one that increases calcium absorption by the intestines. So we saw how PTH works with calcium, and we also saw how PTH works with vitamin D. But we've got one sentence left, and that's to do with phosphate. I already showed you how with bone resorption, PTH can put phosphate along with calcium back into blood. But this statement is the opposite. I'm saying it'll lower plasma phosphate. That's because it reduces phosphate reabsorption and increases its excretion by the kidney. Calcium and phosphate are handled together. If the concentrations of these ions crosses the solubility product, they will precipitate. If that happens, PTH bringing calcium out of bone is pointless because we need to increase the free ionized calcium, which is biologically active. and that's what PTH is trying to fix. So in the kidney, PTH does the opposite on phosphate. It increases calcium reabsorption, but reduces phosphate reabsorption and thus increases phosphate excretion. How does PTH do that? The kidney reabsorbs phosphate in the proximal tubule and the distal tubule. And this is where PTH acts for phosphate. Phosphate gets reabsorbed using sodium phosphate cotransporters. PTH reduces these transporters. It puts them into vesicles, reducing how many can reabsorb phosphate. So what happens? It gets excreted and appears in urine. To put it all together, there's a calcium-sensing receptor on the parathyroid glands. The parathyroid glands produce more PTH when the plasma calcium is low. PTH acts on three organs. In bones, overall, it causes bone resorption and increases calcium and phosphate release. In the kidneys, it increases calcium reabsorption, decreases phosphate reabsorption, increasing phosphate excretion, and also activates vitamin D. And then through that vitamin D, it increases calcium absorption in the small intestine. That's when the plasma calcium is low, more PTH. Instead, when the plasma calcium is high, the release of PTH is inhibited, stopping all of this from happening. Ultimately, it's really important for maintaining calcium and phosphate homeostasis. And in the end, you just need to remember those three sentences. It loves calcium, hates phosphate, and activates vitamin D. That is how the parathyroid hormone works. Sometimes things can go wrong. If the parathyroid glands produce too much PTH, that's called hyperparathyroidism. They could be doing this because there's something wrong with the gland itself. That's primary hyperparathyroidism. But if the gland is fine and something else is telling it to produce more PTH, like for example low calcium from chronic renal failure, that is secondary hyperparathyroidism because the gland is fine. Instead, if there's too little PTH, that's hypoparathyroidism. That's just a start to learning about parathyroid disorders. In addition to these, there's also pseudo-hypoparathyroidism. And believe it or not, there's a pseudo-pseudo-hypoparathyroidism. But the first step to understanding these disorders is knowing about the parathyroid hormone. For that, I hope this video was helpful. If it was, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.